Hey guys, I'm about to join my interview for my final round Amazon internship, and I'm using Interview Coder. So here's how you can do it.
All right, so I found this video and it seems pretty interesting. Now, first and foremost, what this video is a pretty good representation of one viral marketing, because this was basically two paid actors. I don't believe that this person actually did an Amazon OA using the software. The reason why I don't believe that is just because this person is showing their face, and if they actually did this, they would be permanently blacklisted from Amazon. So the risk to reward ratio is not there. They more than likely got paid by this website. The website is named Interview Coder. The edgy way that they're marketing themselves is saying, forget about lead code. We're going to basically solve the problem by giving you a little window that'll show you an AI answer to the problem, which, because so many interviews use lead code, you will basically just see the lead code solution. And from there, it'll probably help you and you can continue on, etc., etc. Now, this is actually pretty interesting. This actually creates a pretty interesting topic for discussion. And I think two things come out of this. One thing is that you definitely should not use this tool when in an actual interview, because if you are caught at Amazon, Facebook, Google, any company doing this as an intern, mid-level engineer, senior, you will permanently get blacklisted. You will never be allowed to interview them, or at least within a 2-year window minimum. And it's not a good reputation, and in general, cheating only stops you from succeeding in life yourself. Yes, it's the Mr. Mackey way of saying not to cheat. Now, granted, people cheat all the time. When it comes to online assessments, people kind of justify it to say that, hey, the OA is unfair anyway, I was really close to getting the answer anyway, I could just Google this or check this or look at my phone. Whatever way you want to justify it, whatever way you want to go about it, fair enough. I mean, there's a obvious element here where, in all reality and in all honesty, a job can mean more to some people than others. If you're literally worrying about living paycheck to paycheck, paying for yourself and your family, I mean, cheating isn't the worst thing ever. I mean, if you need a paycheck and you think you're competent enough to get to the job, especially a company like Amazon where they will quickly fire you, I don't condone it, but I definitely understand where people are coming from. And I'm not going to be corny and sit here and say that these interviews are fair and everything that is set up is fair and that life is fair. And people cheat, and that's why they have the interviews in the first place. I don't condone it. I don't think you should do it. But if it ends up happening, it ends up happening. All I'll say is that I think you should approach it a little bit more holistically, which obviously, in my opinion, is easier for me to say now that I have a couple of years experience under my belt and I have a couple of dollars in the bank account so that I, myself, and my family aren't destitute. Now, the one thing about this is that, again, this is viral marketing. The idea here is to say that you will never have to leak code again. You'll be able to go into an interview. You will be able to essentially solve all problems that are ever given to you. And this is actually not true. And it's basically something that potentially could be a tool to use. But in all reality, if this became a new norm, let's just say interviewers would let you do this. Interviewers can let you do this. And we'll say, you know what? You're going to have a exam with an open book. You could basically Google whatever you want, look at whatever you want, et cetera, et cetera. They would overload you and overcomplicate the problem to the point that you would basically be cooked no matter what. And honestly, there are interviews, and I've been a part of interviews, where you could tell the interviewer was using a ridiculously hard problem and they just wanted to do it. They just wanted to hit you with the moon. And if you survive, good. If you don't, you don't. The thing that you have to understand is that you getting a job at Google, Amazon, Facebook may or may not be as hard as the next person. Someone might go and interview at Amazon and they will get 5 hard dynamic programming questions that are very hard and get them the same job that someone who got asked 5 medium questions would get. There's no standardization when it comes to interviewers. Usually companies try to have a question bank, but it's not very official. It's not mandatory to have any type of rigor or structure around it. It's not academia. And this usually leads to frustration for candidates and sometimes interviewers as well. Now, as I mentioned, I don't think this tool should be used. I think that this tool is being overhyped as, you know, basically a chance to kind of market to say that you'll never have to leak code again. And again, I think the problem with this is that it kind of exposes the whole leak code fallacy of, there are people who will do thousands of problems on LeetCode. They'll try to memorize things, see patterns, and sometimes they'll learn the patterns and from there kind of expand from it, or they'll literally just memorize the problem. And in my opinion, this is not going to work. Even if you memorize a problem, it is not going to help you on the job nor in the interview. And honestly, the more you interview and the more you give people's interviews, because I've worked at Amazon and I currently work at another company and I've interviewed people, and I'm personally, I would think a good interviewer, because do I use lead code questions? Yeah, I usually look at them and I get an idea. I don't necessarily go to the extent of trying to reinvent the wheel and try to make a completely different problem. If you saw the lead code problem, that's fine with me, because I'm not really trying to honestly see you get the right answer or the quote unquote correct answer or optimal answer. That's not the only point. The point is to see how you think. The point is to see how you unpack a problem. In all reality, an interview should be that, just to see how you approach a problem. Imagine if you're going to become a welder, you take a 30-minute, you know, basically test to just see if you can weld. Well, is there a difference between you welding two pieces of metal or you welding a boat to a house? One is ridiculous and one is a lot smaller, and in both examples you might be able to glean a little bit of information as to how the person works. Now, I think what this basically kind of highlights is the stupidity of what lead code interviewing has become. The way candidates basically interview and the way that I interview, I'm currently basically in the process for interviewing Meta. And Meta, in my opinion, I've interviewed with them in the past and I'd say they're fairly fair. I mean, when it comes to the phoner screen, it's usually a medium type of question. Usually you do have to think and think out of the box. At the same time, it's kind of like the nature of this interview. You don't really know what to think or what to, you know, necessarily study for. So you kind of are all over the place looking at any pattern possible to try to figure things out, at least if you're a generalist. If you're someone who's more into machine learning, things can be a little bit more specific, but even there's hardships that come with it. But Meta specifically says in their interview that they do not ask dynamic programming questions. And I think it's because Meta is basically trying to say, hey, listen, we know we can ask you ridiculous questions. We know we can ask you some crazy questions, but we're not going to go down the dynamic programming route, because in my opinion, dynamic programming is sometimes not easily identifiable. And sometimes you look at a problem and because you look at it a certain way, you're not going to be able to find that dynamic solution. And I think that's fair. I think more companies should be a little bit more fair in the types of questions they ask you and try to be a little bit more realistic. In my opinion, one of the hardest interviews I've ever had is I went to an interview at Google. I had two onsites with them. The last onsite I passed, and because they were having firings instead of hirings, I wasn't able to get in. And the interview before that, I made a video about it, basically describing that it was ridiculously hard. And one of the questions I got was a legitimate probability statistics problem that basically used calculus as well as linear algebra that, in my opinion, from a math perspective is hard, never mind just coding it. So that interviewer basically wanted to drop a bomb on me and didn't really care, and it wasn't really fair, despite Google saying that when you interview at Google, you can be asked machine learning questions, you can be asked probability statistics questions, you will be asked dynamic programming questions, because the idea is that you're supposed to just be amazing at everything. But again, my second interview at Google was a lot easier than the first, because at that time the market was better, and surprise, surprise, when the market and economy is better, the interview and interviewer is suddenly easier. That's another element here, is that right now the job market is not great, which means that the interviewers and the questions you'll be faced with is extremely hard. Now, the reason why I say all this is to say that interviewing is pretty much a system and a game that you have to play. It's annoying, it's not fair, and it has a lot of luck involved with it. So why do I say all this? I say all this to say that, honestly, once you start passing these technical screens, you realize there's so much stuff that can still go wrong, whether it comes to the economy of they're not hiring anymore, whether it comes to politics of them just hiring an internal candidate, whether it comes to just bias where they think your solution might be optimal, but they like another solution, very unlikely. Most interviewers could care less. As long as you express your thought process and usually the way you approach it, that's enough. And usually if you get to an optimal solution or near optimal solution, that's also usually enough. But there's so many things that go wrong that the technical portion is actually so small, and that once you get to a point where you're passing these technical questions a little bit more and you're still getting rejected, you will honestly feel a little bit better to say that the game is rigged. You basically need to approach it as a numbers game and from there grow. Now, if that's the case, why not just cheat? Why not just use the software? Why not go that route? The reason why you don't want to do that, other than being blacklisted and cheating yourself out of learning, is that it kind of defeats the whole purpose, and it also is extremely easy to tell when someone is cheating. If someone is giving you the absolute optimal solution, if they're giving you the absolute perfect approach, and they're not really, not necessarily the approach, but just the problem itself. Usually I can tell someone has seen the problem before when they jump right into it and don't ask me questions. And I personally don't care if someone saw the problem before, and I'll ask, for example, one question that I've asked recently to candidates is the top most frequent elements in a string array, and I'll change the wording around, and on lead code, they'll say top K frequent elements. I'll name it top elements, and from there, I'll use the variable X, and I'll notice that subconsciously, while they're solving, they'll say, okay, I want to use the integer K to represent this frequency, and we want to find the top K elements. That kind of tells me that they've probably seen this before, because honestly, when do you use K as an iterative approach or an integer? And I've heard them say similar things that are in the problem statement, but that doesn't matter because I want to see them approach the problem and show me they understand it, because understanding something and just solving it are two different things. You can say A squared plus B squared equals C squared, but do you really know the relationship these items have to a circle? Do you really know how to explain these pieces? Do you just memorize the formula? Or if you do academia and go past your bachelor's, usually you get into something called rigor, where you really have a better understanding of things and a fulfillment where it's not just that you know how to solve a problem, but you know the context in which it's in. And it's something where when you do these interviews, the idea is that you're supposed to approach it in a way where you're explaining yourself, explaining how you solve the problem. And from there, you actually create a process where you share your perspective with the interviewer and you basically show your skills for problem solving. And that's how it's supposed to work. Again, there's just so much unfairness that happens in the interview process. It's a very small, short window to show that you do or do not know something. It's very up in the air whether you will or will not see a problem that you've seen before. It's not a mystery that when I see problems that I've practiced, I usually know how to approach it. And also, you don't get brownie points usually for actually having your eureka moment and deriving something. Imagine that you were someone who was given a way to sort numbers and that you derive radix sort. You figure out that you can use radix sort to do this in near linear time. And it's interviewers usually don't care. They're just like, okay, he did radix sort. Whether he got to it holistically or just memorized it, they don't care. That's a problem. I think that's a huge problem because the effort that some people put in, I've seen people not get the right answer, but they've gone down the proper streets, proper avenues, but just didn't make that connection. And I'll usually give them a nudge, I'll usually give them a hint, and that usually does make a connection. And that's another thing here too, is that if you do cheat, if you do use this, it actually doesn't make that big of a difference, because in my opinion, when I was first starting out interviewing, I would see things like Dijkstra's algorithm, and unless I copy-pasted that, I would not understand it. And I didn't understand how the whole heap mechanic worked and how to use the map for it and how to organize it through the array. But now it's become a little bit more fundamental. I understand it. I won't lie to you and say that I simply derive it every time. I do remember pieces of it where you first construct the array. After constructing the array, you usually want to make a while loop. And in this while loop, what you're going to be doing is accessing members of the heap. And as you access members of the heap, you iterate over the largest item in the list. And the list piece is what's in the heap. So I do remember some pieces of it, but at the same time, I do understand the point of Dijkstra's algorithm. I do remember the pieces that go with it. And I think that without that level, you really can't explain yourself in the interview, and the interviewer will notice that, and they'll realize that you're either A, cheating, or you've seen the problem before. And then they will down-level your kind of contribution for the problem. And more than likely, if you solve it within, and this is another thing that's annoying, if you solve the problem within 15, 20 minutes when it should have taken 45, you're going to get a harder version of the problem or another problem. And again, I don't know what to say. I personally don't do that. I usually will just pick a problem that I think should take 30 minutes. If it takes 10 for some reason, let's talk about it more. Let's go over about it a little bit more. I usually don't try to poke and prod people to the point that they're failing. The point is kind of just to see how they think. And I think that honestly, the only positive that might come out of this is that interviewers will be held to a higher standard to be a little bit more fair. You usually, as a candidate, have about 45 minutes for an interview, 10 minutes is behavioral, the other 30 to 35 is going to be, or actually 30 is going to be problem solving. The last 5 to 10 is going to be questions for the interviewer. I think it'd be better if interviewers were a little bit more empathetic. It doesn't matter how bad the economy is. People can get rejected because there's no money or better candidates without giving them ridiculous probability statistics problems, machine learning problems when they're not a machine learning specialist, et cetera, et cetera. Where, hey, what is the big deal here if you quote unquote lower the bar by having these common problems where people understand it and they can explain it? And if their work experience aligns with it and they're able to explain it and they're saying what basically needs to hit the spot, what's the problem with that exactly? Because the only thing that honestly this whole interviewer space even really presents is the element of the unknown. When I go to an interview, I don't know if it's going to be a dynamic programming problem. I don't know if it's going to be a linear algebra problem. I don't know if it's going to be a regular greedy algorithm problem. So I don't really know what to study. So I end up studying everything. It's good to have a breadth of knowledge. Yes, that's true. But do you do that in school? Do you go to a math exam not knowing if you are going to have to brush up on algebra or brush up on calculus or brush up on trigonometry? Is there any real worth in going to college, school, and so on, where you have a structured way of learning and a structured way of testing, and then you go into the real world and basically say that everything's on the table and at the same time, nothing's on the table? I think the problem is, honestly, that a lot of these companies don't have a power bank or a problem bank for people to go off of. I think that would be helpful. Meta does do this. That is another thing that Meta does do well at. They do give you kind of like 30 problems that you can look at. And the idea is that if you're able to understand those 30 problems, they should give you a better idea and way of dealing with their interview. It's not one-to-one and it's not guaranteed, but again, it's something. In my opinion, I think it honestly would be a lot more fair to give candidates 100 questions and say, hey, listen, of this 100 questions, there's certain patterns and problems and things that you should know. And when it comes to the interview day, there's going to be about, you know, maybe 20% of this is going to be applicable to the interview. But at least we've zoned it out where instead of you spending hundreds of hours studying, maybe it'll be a couple 48, 72 hours of studying. You'll be able to basically go through these problems and whatever you're weak at, you can focus on. And whatever you're strong at, you can just think about explaining. Is there something wrong with that? Does that all of a sudden dilute the pool of talent? Does that all of a sudden lower the bar? I don't know. I've been hearing a lot about the exemplary engineers and how they're amazing, but they're getting replaced by AI anyway, right? So why not just make the interview process easier? And when I say easier, I just mean a little bit more palpable and a little bit more digestible, where people who are juniors will be able to have a better idea of how to approach it. People who are mid-level seniors will also be able to approach it in a certain way. And honestly, the senior interview is already something that becomes harder because you're going to be asked usually a design question that you might have a specialty area around it, you might have touched it, you might have not, but at least that's a little bit more rooted in reality. And there are usually strict patterns that usually are within a small confinement, as opposed to problem solving, which you can approach in many different ways. So I think that this kind of shows the kind of lackluster and very archaic way that interviews are done. I think that moving forward, this is not going to change much of anything, because why would it change? People figured out, hey, these companies ask these type of questions. If I want to excel, I'll just go online and practice these questions. I'll kind of roll the dice and try to do patterns and try to figure these things out and kind of get lucky. And it's been going along good enough so far, but if you want to be a little bit more equitable, if you want to give everyone a chance, if you want to level the playing field, because honestly, as someone who kind of graduated from college, they never mentioned this in school. If it wasn't for the internet, I wouldn't even know that you should go do LeetCode and do these problems. So I think that transparency can help. I think that a shift in the way this interview system can help. But all in all, I honestly wonder what'll happen now that more and more people are able to more easily cheat, basically. And from there, how does the interview change? And how good does the interviewer have to be in order to identify things that they're looking for? And honestly, there's really no rule book for that either. If there was a better structure for what to test for and what to look for, it might contribute to a better interview experience as well.